Throw your hands in the air right now, man.
Good afternoon, class. Just got back from this meeting. Was at, how is it? I don't even know. Today, James and John over there are going to be teaching you guys about how to use math in microbiology. I just got to set this screen up. John Henry, why don't you come up here and help me set this screen up? Over there playing hockey, forward, all that stuff, playing rugby. All right, so, I need my clicker. Oh, here it is. Hello? It's my wife. My wife getting all this shit that I don't need. What we got here? Oh, my flute. I was using this at church the other day. My Adderall. Oh no, it's my Pepto-Bismol. I had this piece of chicken the other day. I think my stomach's really gonna respond pretty violently, so got this for later. Ben, why don't you come over here? Actually, Ben, get this table out of here. I'll let you do that. I'm gonna go turn the lights on. In here, gotta turn the lights up a little.
Just live this here lifestyle. We came straight from the bottom to the top. My lifestyle. Living life like a beginning. This is only beginning.
Hello, class. Today we will be talking about the growth curve. Now, you've seen the four phases here: the lag phase, exponential, or the growth phase. We'll be focusing on the stationary phase, where the cells reach an equilibrium, and then the death phase. So, you've seen this equation many times. You have a log of a composition at some point minus the log of the initial composition of cells divided by some factor times the time is equal to your k value. And then, of course, the doubling time is 1 over that k value. So we see that fancy equation, but how do we really get this equation? Well, the answer is using calculus. So you can think of it as a delta of the total cells divided by that number of cells times a delta time. So in this case, the n would represent the x's, and your t would be the denominator here, that t function. So this is equal to your growth rate. Now that's not calculus yet, so what we need to look at. So what that function says now is we'll be looking at some n at a later time, or minus some n at an earlier time. Trace these down to the x-axis, and you get your delta t. That's algebra, that's easy stuff. So calculus says, well, what's the rate at this exact point? So to get that answer, you narrow down your range of t's into an exact precise point. So assuming this delta becomes a derivative, the equation is simply dn divided by dt, and multiplying the n over gives you your growth rate times the number of cells.
So we're gonna bring n over because we wanna relate the number of cells to the number of cells changing. And then we're gonna bring the dt over here, signifying our time change. We're gonna solve this from our initial number of cells to our final number of cells over the period of time that's gonna take. And now you'll learn more about this if you take math courses. The result of that is this. And so we're looking at this equation and we wanna solve for doubling time. So for simplicity, we're going to take nf equals 2, n0 equals 1. Doubling 1 is 2. We could take 150, it doesn't matter because 2 divided by 1, 100 divided by 50 is 2 in both cases. So that's ln of 2 is equal to rt. R is equal to ln of 2 over t. So are these equations the same? Okay, so arbitrarily we're going to pick some numbers. We're going to pick 40 is the number of cells we get when we're measuring, but we started with 10 cells. And we're going to do this over 2 hours. Hypothetically, let's say this happened in that situation. If over 2 hours, our number of cells went from 10 to 40, then the math would work out where k is equal to 1, and 1 over k is equal to our doubling time, which is also 1.
All right, so looking back at our curve, natural log versus time, what James did over there so kindly was starting at 10 cells and ending at 40 cells. Over a certain amount of time, you get the slope growth rate, or R. Now looking back at our calculus equation we derived over here, shift back over here now, we have this slope, R, is equal to 0.69. That equals the natural log of 2, because this is a doubling time problem, divided by the t, or the doubling time. Now solving this equation for t by multiplying on both sides, we have t equals 1 hour, just like how James derived over there.
All right, so we have a nice practice problem for you guys here. So, Coop ignores the warning signs and eats a piece of 4-month-old chicken at 4:30 p.m. He then drives home at 4:55 p.m. when he feels the urge to defecate. The gas station on Route 896 is 5 minutes away. Assuming the E. coli started doubling at a rate of 0.1386 per minute, and Coop ingested 156 bacteria, will he make it to the gas station in time, or will he have to hit up the litter box in the back seat? Note, Coop will automatically defecate at 10,000 bacteria. So, very real life example.
All right, so let's see just how screwed Coop is. So starting with the equation James derived earlier. So derivative of change in cells with respect to time is equal to the rate times the number of cells. So we have the natural log of number of cells at a specific time, 30 minutes later, minus the natural log of the number of cells initially, which we were given as 156, is equal to the rate of cell growth, 1.386 times the time, which is 30 minutes. So doing this, we find that n of t is equal to 9,999.99 cells. So, I would advise Dr. Cooper that you try to make it to the bathroom, but it's gonna be close. Take the litter box as that backup. You'll be fine. All right, class, so before we finish up the little session for today, I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about mathematics and virology. So a big concept in virology is the R-naught factor. So that is if I have the virus and I infect just one person, the R-naught becomes 1. If I have the virus and I have the measles or something like that, R-naught is 12 to 18, I would infect 12 to 18 different people. So the kind of contagious of the virus. So represent that by VC, the critical level of vaccination to make sure the virus doesn't spread and hurt the population in a negative way. So we set that equal to, and it's kind of intuitive, we do 1 minus 1 over R naught. So that's the equation we have written. Coop, what are you doing?
Oh, I'm sorry, John, I got distracted.
So a mathematical way to show this critical vaccination level is through a graph looking at cases per day plotted against the vaccination. So for a very contagious virus, such as measles, we would expect that VC intersects somewhere near 100%. So that means that nearly 100% of the population has to be vaccinated in order for that virus to reach the case of 0 per day. Now for a virus such like the flu, it's a lot better that way, is that it actually only requires about 50% of the total population to be vaccinated to reach a case of A per 0. So
Coop, I just wanted to say thanks for a great semester. You're the best teacher we've ever had. I love you, bro. And yeah, you meant so much for this class. Made it such a great time.
You're definitely one of the most genuine people I know. I will miss you greatly and definitely visit you. Thank you, Dr. Cooper. Cheers. Adrian Bowie.